wonderful song in it. God, I love that song. It chokes me up. Yeah, I'll clear the whole room if I sing it. I'm Bill Cook. Bill Cook. Bill Cook.
Bill Cook.
Those of you have never heard that before. he's been an office president and senior partner of the state's largest architectural firm. He holds 2 undergraduate degrees from UNC Charlotte. He is a graduate of UNC Charlotte College of Agriculture. Let's try that again. Anyway. He's active in his community and church. He's here with his wife, Alice, and they reside in Raleigh with 4 children. I like a little personal thing. He's currently serving as our lieutenant governor, and he's the president of the Senate, and he's got a really tough job in the Senate. He's got about 50 very large egos to try to control. He does a great job. I give you, with great pleasure, Dan Forrest.
It's great to see you all tonight. It's always great to be back in Beaufort County in Washington. And this is not an exaggeration. You can ask my wife, and she'll attest to this. I tell people ask me, say you saw all these great places in North Carolina. What's your favorite place? And I always tell them it's Washington, North Carolina. So Washington is a beautiful town. The sound's kind of going in and out here, so I might like yell at you every once in a while. Don't mean to. This is a great opportunity. Yeah. The sound with no sound. It's a great opportunity. After you win an election, there's only so much time that you have to travel the state and tell people thank you for the work that they did. So this is my opportunity to come back and say thank you. So many of you have worked so hard over the past couple years to get people elected, and I couldn't be here today without you. And it was already, my wife Alice was introduced earlier, but I would not be here at all without Alice. I mean, she was my biggest supporter, biggest helper that I could possibly have, obviously being home raising the kids as well. And so she's just a tremendous support. And the one thing that, there's actually something that Senator Cook and Senator Sanderson and I all have in common, and that's we married way up, way over our heads. But we, as I was mentioned earlier, we made history this time around. It's something you should really all be proud of. First time we've ever had the executive branch of government, the House and the Senate, and also the Supreme Court, all being Republican. It's the third time we've elected a Republican governor, second time we've elected a Republican lieutenant governor. I'm only the second Republican lieutenant governor since 1897. So that's pretty crazy. So there's a lot of great things going on, but I wanted to just touch on this first. One of the things that we did that you should all be proud of, because this is just a great cross-section representation of grassroots North Carolina, and one of the things that we can be proud of is we won a grassroots campaign. By the time our campaign was finished, we had traveled well over 250,000 miles. We'd been to all 100 counties, most of them many times. And we just reached out to the people. And we didn't have a lot of money. We got outspent on media about $2 million to $20,000. That was the difference in the media spending. And so our campaign was just proof that you can still win grassroots. The other thing it proved is that you can win by running a positive campaign. And people are, people say all the time, they're tired of mudslinging, they're tired of dirty politics. And for 2 years, we ran across the state. We never said one negative word about any of our 5 opponents. We usually didn't even mention them by name anywhere we went. And that just proves that you can win a campaign by being positive and running on the issues. And so that's something we should all expect. The other thing that our campaign proves is that every vote counts. One thing that Bill Cook and I can both say, every vote counts. So if you ever hear a neighbor or a friend say, oh, my vote doesn't count, my vote doesn't matter, you can point to us, and we are the poster children for that phrase. So we thank you for your vote. You know, I'm going to just go through a little bit of what we're doing in Raleigh right now and what we've inherited there. You know, the Senate and the House have been doing their thing for a couple of years. They're well on their they have their feet on the ground. They're running bills through, doing a lot of great stuff in the House and the Senate. The executive team, we just won for the first time in a couple of decades, and you start turning over rocks and you start realizing there's a mess there. We really inherited a mess in a lot of ways, and one of the things that we're trying to do is bring a business-minded approach to government and a customer service attitude to government as well. You know, we got elected to serve you. We are public servants. We're here to serve you. It's not the other way around. And that's real important. So while we're in Raleigh, we need to make sure we keep that focus as well. There's a number of things. I'm just going to hit really on a few today. But one of the things that we found out in Raleigh was that we really have no common IT infrastructure, information technology infrastructure in our state. You know, every agency runs their own proprietary system. Every university just about runs their own proprietary system. The community colleges do. And the different departments in Raleigh, the House and the Senate have their own systems. And so we have no means as a government to communicate across with the 90,000 employees that we employ in Raleigh. And this is a big problem in this day and age. Just one case in point, we hired a new CIO, new Chief Information Officer, a man named Chris Estes, and he comes to Raleigh from the business world. He comes from Booz Allen as a business technology consultant, and he's taken over IT. And so he, first day on his job, he said, you know, I want to go out, I want to talk to my employees. And he found out very quickly that he couldn't, there was no system in place to allow him to communicate with his employees. So he very quickly as well found out that they had a PA system in their building, and had probably never been used before. And so he went down to the security room, and he said, walked in and said, I want to talk to my employees over the PA system. And they said, well, you can't do that. That's for emergencies only. And so he said, no, I'm going to do it. So he got on, and you know, I'm sure he probably scared everybody to death when the voice of God comes over the PA system. But he was able to talk to his employees that way, not all of them, but most of them in his building. And the very next day, the liberal bloggers came out and said, you know, what an idiot we have for a CIO, because he doesn't even know how to use email. Well, there was no means to use email. There's no internet site. There's no phone system site. And this is what we're up against in a lot of ways in government. This is one analogy, that some things are so far behind. You know, all of you now can go home. You can take your devices like your iPhones or your iPads or your computers, and you can have wireless at home, and you can move around and do business. If you're in the business world, your whole office is generally wired, and you can move around. That's what the business world does now. Not so in government. You know, if I want to get wireless in my office, which I don't have, by the way, I use a little MiFi device that I buy myself, you know, from Verizon, and that's how I get my wireless. If I want to do that, it costs me $1,500 a month to do that in my office. So there's a lot of things that are going to be big challenges that we're facing. Another just quick example is Department of Health and Human Services, and you've heard a lot of this through the years, the challenges we face in Health and Human Services. But Aldona Vosh took over the Health and Human Services Department. Now this is a $20 billion organization. $20 billion a year flows through Health and Human Services in North Carolina. They have 18,000 employees. Just like ITS, she can't communicate with her staff. She has no means to communicate with her staff at all. Out of 18,000 employees, there's only 85 employees that the Secretary of Health and Human Services can hire or fire. She only has 85 out of 18,000 that she can hire or fire. That's all she has under her control to do that. She got there and found out that she had no budget director. She had no chief information officer. She had no chief financial officer. She didn't have a chief of staff. She didn't have any contract writing standards in her department. She didn't have a human resources director. This is a $20 billion organization, 18,000 employees. And so she starts off from scratch. We found out when we get there that we had paid something like $390 million for an information system, a technology system for Department of Health and Human Services to get all this stuff up and running. And I had a friend that did the math on that, and this was something like, if you were paying a programmer $300,000 a year for 2,500 years, you would, that's how long it takes to do this. So, you know, there's just all kinds of things like that that are great challenges within government. And those are some of the things we're working on. The other thing that we found is that there's a lot of facilities within state government that are in disrepair. Somewhere between $4 and $6 billion of repairs needed to state facilities. And you might say, well, why is that? Well, that's because for decades, the people in charge of Raleigh had taken money out of the general fund, out of their renovation repair budgets, and put it into the general fund to balance the budget. So it's taken the money out of doing the things that we would all have to do in our home. You know, if we want to put a new roof on our house, and we have to save up to do that. You know, obviously our credit cards are all maxed out. There is no new money. And so we're going to have to find very creative ways to take care of some of the challenges that we have. We moved into our office. Lieutenant Governor, it's a big old house, and we had a lot of challenges about a lot of things that we had to do to come in and just make it workable. And so I went out as an architect. I called a lot of favors, and we had a lot of friends that came in, and we had people painting the place for us for free, putting new furniture in, they're all giving this to the state, by the way, for free. Painting the place, new carpet, doing the hardwood floors, putting in a new kitchen, new appliances, new furniture, all for free. They're all gifts to you, the people of North Carolina. And that's just a different day in government. It's a different mindset. That's what business people do when they come to Raleigh or Washington, is they find out ways that the private sector can help out and do things and not put the burden on the taxpayer. So we've got to continue to get the burden off the taxpayer, and a lot of these facility issues are going to cost a lot of political capital. These aren't things that win you votes, but they're things that have to be taken care of. So what's going on now? I can say this, you're in good hands right now. The people that the governor selected to run these agencies come to Raleigh, as I mentioned, with a business-minded approach or a customer service approach to government, and that's a good thing. Many of them, actually all of them, have made great sacrifices to come to Raleigh. Several of them are making no salary at all. They're doing it for free for you, and that's a good thing. They have all left their families behind to some degree. Some of their families are trying to move to Raleigh and making sacrifices that way. They've all made significant financial sacrifices to be there. But you're in good hands with really good business people running the departments. You know, one of the things we found down east especially was when we'd ask business people, so what's your greatest challenge? Almost the number one issue all the time was Diener, Department of Environment and Natural Resources. Everybody said Diener. And so... So Diener has a new man in charge, a man named John Scavarla, who does come from a sustainability business background, but he comes with a business-minded approach to government, and he's already transformed the place just overnight, allowing businesses to do things that businesses haven't been able to do in North Carolina for decades. So we're getting the burden of big government off the backs of the people to allow business to grow and to flourish. So I like to say that this role of Lieutenant Governor, you know, I preside over the Senate, as was mentioned, and so that's a lot of fun. I enjoy doing that. It's kind of like herding cats sometimes, but it is a lot of fun. And when I'm not doing that, I also sit on the State Board of Education. That's one of my constitutional duties. I sit on the North Carolina Board of Community Colleges. I sit on the North Carolina Board of Economic Development. I sit on the Military Affairs Commission. I'm the chair of the E-Learning Commission. And a number of other smaller things that I do as well in regards to that. And we do all that with four staff. So we have four staff. The lieutenant governors before us had 12 to 16 staff. Ours has been cut down to four. But you know what? That's good government. That's what you're supposed to do as a conservative. You're supposed to run as lean and mean as efficiently as you can. So the lieutenant governor is really, you know, you're not part of the governor's cabinet. You're not really in the Senate, even though you are the president of the Senate. So you find yourself on this island between two rivers. You know that you have this river of legislation that's running really fast. House and Senate is moving really quick and putting things out there. And then you have the governor's river that's moving much more slowly. And they're trying to put a budget together. And they're trying to get their feet on the ground and all this kind of stuff. So you find yourself having a foot in each river. Sometimes you're playing peacemaker between the legislature and the governor. Sometimes you're getting involved in legislation. But it's a good place to be. And so there's two things going on. The executive side has the discovery phase. And so again, discovering a lot of things on the executive side. And on the legislative side, there's a lot of great stuff going on. And I'm just going to get to stand up here right now and talk to you about all the great stuff that Senator Cook and Senator Sanderson and Representative Speciale are all doing. So this is not stuff that I'm doing. This is stuff they're doing. But you've probably heard that we said no to the state health care exchange, Obamacare. We said no. Medicaid expansion in North Carolina. Didn't want to do that either. We said we're going to reform unemployment insurance in North Carolina. There's a lot of people out there that are struggling, and unemployment insurance is supposed to be a safety net. And over the years, it's turned into a hammock. And we really can't have a hammock here. We need to get people back to work in North Carolina. You know, we started to eliminate unnecessary boards and commissions, things that we're not doing anything in North Carolina. There's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of boards and commissions, and many of them don't do anything. And so doing that, there's going to be some new school choice legislation coming down the pike. It's going to say, you know what, we're going to, break the state government controlled monopoly on education, introduce choice, introduce competition. Competition spurs innovation, and innovation changes the face of education in North Carolina. So it's a new day. It's a new day. I mentioned that I sit on the State Board of Education. Right now, I'm the only Republican on the State Board of Education. That's a very interesting place to be. And so a lot of times I sit there very quietly, and when votes come up, they all say yes, and I say no. And, everybody turns around, looks at me, and is like, wait, nobody's ever said no at this board before. It's the first time we've seen that. So I'm their kind of freak show on the State Board of Education. But in a couple months, that all changes. In a couple months, we'll have new board members. And for the first time in the history of North Carolina, we'll have a conservative state board of education. We passed some legislation that was run by Senator Tillman that created a new high school diploma called career-ready track diploma in North Carolina. So it's there's a college-ready track and a career-ready track. Those people that want to go off and get a job and go to community colleges, that's a good thing for our state, because there's a lot of people that don't want a four-year degree, and there's a lot of people that don't need a four-year degree. This allows them to get a diploma and go to work. So that was a big deal. You're going to see photo voter ID come up next. So that's a complete game changer as well. We all know that is. You know, people say on the other side, there's been no proof of voter fraud. That's kind of laughable. You know, in my race alone, we were preparing for a possible runoff in our race, and we had literally our attorneys ready to file suit against 6,000 ballots. They were easy. They were no brainers. 6,000 ballots that we identified, 3,000 were up at East Carolina University, where people literally went and registered with their Amazon and PayPal account, registered to vote, which is illegal, and they allowed them to vote anyway. So these kind of things, photo voter ID is a game changer, absolute game changer. So you're also going to see continued regulatory reform in North Carolina. The House and Senate have been working on that for a couple of years. And, you know, I'm a firm believer that every time you put a law on the books, you should take a law off the books and continue to simplify government. The other thing that's going to come is tax reform. And so I would encourage all of you to get engaged in tax reform. This is a really big deal. Senator Rucho's in charge of that now. He said early on, it's something that I think all of us have talked about on the campaign trail. I personally would like to see us eliminate the personal income tax and the corporate income tax in North Carolina. And Senator Rucho said that's his plan too. I don't think we're going to get all the way there. There's going to be some compromises going on, but as long as we start the process of eliminating those income taxes, we're going to be moving in the right direction, because all the states in America who have done that are the states that are flourishing economically right now. They're the states that are creating jobs. I mean, put yourself in the mind, into the head of a businessman, a CEO. Put yourself in their mind. If you're moving your company from New York to another state, who are you going to go to first? Are you going to go to the state that is number one for business tax climate, or the state that is number 44 for business tax climate? We're number 44 right now. Highest personal income tax, highest corporate income tax, highest gas tax in the Southeast. Some of the highest in the nation. So we have to transform that. When we do, then we're going to open up our doors to business in North Carolina. So I also think that, you know, we need to set a kind of a bold vision for what's going on in our state. And there's four things that I lift up. I think that these are important goals that we can set as a state. I believe we should be number one in the world in education. Set a goal to be number one in the world in education. People say, well, how are you going to do that? You know, how are you going to do that? So, well, you do it just like you do in the business world. If you start a company and you want to be number one in your company, you put a vision out there, You put the tactical plan in place, you start doing things, and you start measuring those things. This is something we don't do in government. Government doesn't like to measure things. We like to throw things out there and then to see what happens to them. You know, we spend billions of dollars doing it, and we spend billions of dollars doing something else. But we track our changes, and we can really set a course to be number one. I think we should also be number one in employment in America. Number one in employment. Right now, we're number 45 in employment in America. There's only five states that have worse unemployment than North Carolina. That's just not acceptable for our state. Set a goal to be number one. Set a goal to be number one in energy in America. We have great natural resources in North Carolina. We have a great natural gas vein that runs through the middle of our state that we know will create tens of thousands of jobs right away. We believe we have great natural gas opportunities off the coast of North Carolina. We have potential oil possibilities. There's a lot of things we can do in North Carolina to set a course to be energy independent. I say, why not be the first energy independent state in America? And allow North Carolina to do that. And I also believe we should be number one in efficiency in government in the country. We should run the most efficient, transparent government in the United States. I believe that every one of us should be able to go online today and know where every single dollar we send into Raleigh is going. And when we get to that place, when we get to that point of transparency in government, we're going to have true accountability in government. That's the only way you'll have accountability is if you have transparency. So we need to move in that direction. So in wrapping up, I believe that we can save America. I believe we can save America, but you know where it starts? It doesn't start in Washington, D.C. It doesn't start with the president. It doesn't start with the Congress. It starts right here. Grassroots North Carolina is where it starts. It starts by putting pressure on your local governments, on your county commissions and your city councils and your school boards. And then they put pressure on your state government. Your state government puts pressure on the federal government. And then you start to see America change. One state at a time. And let's start with North Carolina. And I also believe, like I know many of you do, that it is truly time in America to throw political correctness out the window. Political correctness is killing our country. Our nation is truly founded on the idea that we all have the freedom, the liberty, the ability to take our ideas and express them in public and to share those ideas with people and to be a part of the debate. When one side comes and tells you these are the things you can say and these are the things you can't say, your radar should go up immediately. You know, we need to say no to political correctness, and we need to stand for the things that we believe in this country. Stand up and fight for our First Amendment rights. Stand up and fight for our Second Amendment rights. Stand up and fight for our Tenth Amendment rights. Our founding fathers were very clear. They believed that the power should reside with the states, not with the national government. That's called federalism, and federalism is under attack, as you know. We need to continue to fight for the things that are dear to us in North Carolina. We need to push back. We need people that are strong enough in our states to stiff-arm the federal government and say, no, you're not going to take those rights and those powers away from us, and we're just going to say no to you. And finally, remember that we all answer to a higher power. I don't stand before you now because there's anything special about Dan Forrest. I stand before you now because I am here just representing a good God. You know, God establishes leaders and he deposes leaders. And that's very clear. It's a very clear biblical construct. He establishes leaders, he deposes leaders, no matter which side you're on. We don't have the right ideas. All good ideas come from a higher power. They come from God. And we need to remember that in government as well. So I thank you for your time. I thank you for everything you're doing. I thank you for allowing me to come and speak, and my wife and I and daughter Olivia for being able to be here with you as well. We hope we get to come back to Washington for vacation soon rather than just speaking. So God bless you all. Thank you for your time. I look forward to seeing you again.